Welcome to my channel, Anupama Biology Classes. In this molecular biology series, today our topic is translation. It means protein synthesis. This video is taken from CBSC Class 12, Chapter 6, Part 3. Before this video, we discussed about replication and transcription. Now in this video, our topic is translation. So let's come on the topic, that is translation, which means synthesis of proteins. So, what is translation? Translation is the mechanism by which the triplet base sequence of an mRNA guides the linking of a specific sequence of amino acids to form a polypeptide on ribosomes. So, it is a core biological process occurring inside cells, balancing the loss of cellular proteins through the production of new proteins. Proteins perform a variety of critical functions as enzymes, structural proteins, or hormones, and therefore are crucial biological component. Now, the machinery for the protein synthesis. Protein synthesis requires amino acids, DNA, RNAs, ribosomes, and enzymes. And in this machinery, at first, amino acids as raw material. Proteins are the polymers of amino acids. Therefore, amino acids form the raw material for the protein synthesis, and these are available in the cytoplasmic matrix as an amino acid pool. Second is DNA as specificity control. A cell, in order to maintain its own special characteristics, must manufacture proteins exactly similar to those present already in it. Thus, protein synthesis requires specificity control to provide instructions about the exact sequence in which the given number and kinds of amino acids should be linked to get the desired polypeptide. And third is RNAs as intermediaries. RNA serves as the intermediaries between the DNA and proteins in a cell. And the last is ribosomes as protein factories. Ribosomes are tiny ribonucleoprotein particles without a covering membrane, and they serve as the site for the protein synthesis, hence they are called protein factories. Now, here you can see the structure of ribosome and their binding sites and role in the protein synthesis. So, each ribosome consists of large and a small subunit, and the subunits of the ribosomes occur separately when not involved in protein synthesis. The two subunits form association when protein synthesis starts and undergo dissociation when protein synthesis stops. So, many ribosomes line up on the mRNA chain during the protein synthesis, and such a row of active ribosomes is called a polyribosomes or simply polysome. Now here in this picture you can see a binding site on the ribosome. So, a ribosome has one binding site for the mRNA and three binding sites for the tRNA. In this picture, you can see that is first P site, that is peptidyl tRNA site that holds the tRNA carrying the growing polypeptide chain. Second is A site, which is known as amino acyl tRNA site, which holds the tRNA carrying next amino acid to be added to the chain. And the last is recently discovered E site, that is exit site, where discharged tRNA leaves the ribosome. So these sites span across the large subunit of the ribosome. However, the first tRNA amino acid complex directly enters the P site of the ribosome. Now, if we talk about the eukaryotic ribosomes, in this case, a groove at the junction of the two subunits present. From this groove, a tunnel extends through the large subunit and open into a canal of the endoplasmic reticulum. The polypeptides are synthesized in the groove between the two ribosomal subunit and pass through the tunnel of the large subunit into the endoplasmic reticulum. While in the groove, the developing polypeptide is protected from the cellular enzymes. The small subunit forms a cap over the large subunit. The large subunit attaches to the endoplasmic reticulum by two glycoproteins named riboforin first and second. So, if we talk about the role or function of the ribosome, it is responsible to hold in position the mRNA, tRNA and the associated enzymes, controlling the process until a peptide bond forms between the adjacent amino acids. Now, the mechanism of protein synthesis. So, protein synthesis is an elaborate process and occurs in following steps, in which the first step is activation of amino acid. So, how the amino acid activated? tRNA activating enzyme attached to the ATP and amino acid. Then it forms the amino acid AMP complex and a specific tRNA molecule is recruited. Then the tRNA is bound to the amino acid and AMP is released. Now the charged tRNA is produced. So in this process, in amino acid activation, amino acid reacts with the ATP to form an amino acid AMP complex and pyrophosphate. The reaction is catalyzed by a specific amino acid activating enzyme which is called amino acid tRNA synthetase in the presence of magnesium ion, and this is a separate amino acid tRNA synthetase enzyme for each kind of amino acid. So because of this, for the 20 amino acids, 20 different enzymes are present. Much of the energy released by the separation of phosphate group from ATP is trapped in the amino acid AMP complex. The complex remains temporarily associated with the enzyme. The amino acid AMP enzyme complex is called activated amino acid, and the pyrophosphate is hydrolyzed to 2-pyrophosphate, driving the reaction to the right. So, if we talk about the reaction involved in the amino acid activation, amino acid attached to the ATP, and here in presence of activating enzyme and magnesium ion, it converted into amino acid AMP enzyme complex plus pyrophosphate. Now, how will amino acid be activated? So, because of this, here you can see that all the process, that how the amino acid activated. After this, the second step, that is charging of tRNA. And if we talk about the charging of tRNA, in this picture you can see here, the amino acid AMP enzyme complex joins to the amino acid binding site of its specific tRNA, where its carboxyl group bonds to hydroxyl group of the terminal base triplet, that is CCA. The reaction is catalyzed by the same amino acid tRNA synthetase enzyme. The resulting tRNA amino acid complex is now called charged tRNA, that is amino acid tRNA, and AMP and enzymes are freed. The freed enzyme can activate and attach another amino acid molecule to another tRNA molecule. So, the energy released by the change of the ATP to AMP is retained in the amino acid tRNA complex, and this energy is later used to drive the formation of peptide bond when amino acid linked together on ribosomes. So, in the complete reaction of the activation or charging of the tRNA, at first, the amino acid AMP enzyme complex attached with the tRNA in the presence of enzyme amino acid tRNA synthetase and form tRNA amino acid complex, and here AMP released and enzyme released. So this is the process of charging of tRNA. In this picture, you can see the first and second step combined. At first, binding of amino acid to the ATP by activating enzyme amino acid tRNA synthetase and form activated amino acid. Then, this activated amino acid combined with tRNA in presence of enzyme amino acid tRNA synthetase, that is same in the both process, to form tRNA amino acid complex, which is charged tRNA molecule. So, now this tRNA amino acid complex moves to the site of the protein synthesis, that is the ribosome. Now, the third step, that is the activation of ribosomes. The small and large subunit of the ribosomes must be joined together for the protein synthesis. Then, this is brought about by the mRNA chain. The latter joins the small ribosomal subunit by first codon through base pairing with the appropriate sequence on the RNA. And then the combination of two is called initiation complex, which in this picture you can see here. The large subunit later joins the small subunit forming active ribosomes, and the activation of ribosomes by mRNA requires proper concentration of magnesium ion. So in this picture you can see here the small ribosomal subunit joined by the large ribosomal subunit, and this structure is known as translation initiation complex, and this is the activated ribosome. After this process, the fourth step, which is assembly of amino acid, it means the polypeptide formation. So if we talk about the polypeptide formation, in this step there are three stages. First one is initiation, then elongation, and the last one is termination of the amino acid chain. So the first step is initiation of polypeptide chain. Here in this picture you can see the translation initiation. Initiation stage brings together an mRNA, a tRNA bearing the first amino acid of the polypeptide and the two subunits of a ribosome. Union of all these components forms the translation initiation complex, which you can see in this picture. First, a small subunit of a ribosome attached to mRNA and a specific charged initiator tRNA. So, the ribose subunit bind to the leader segment at the fifth end of the mRNA. In case of prokaryotes, rRNA of the small subunit base pairs with a specific sequence of the nucleotides in the mRNA's leader segment. In eukaryotes, the fifth cap first tells the small subunit to bind to the mRNA fifth end. Downstream on the mRNA lies in the initiator codon, that is AUG, which signals the start of translation. The initiator tRNA joins to the initiation codon by its anticodon through hydrogen bonds, and it carries the amino acid, that is formal methionine in prokaryotes and methionine in case of eukaryotes. Now the larger subunit of ribosomes joins the smaller subunit, and this completes the translation initiation complex. At this stage, the initiator tRNA lies at the P site of the ribosome, and the A site is vacant to let another charged tRNA to enter. So this is the complete structure of the initiation of the polypeptide chain, which in this picture you can see. That is, first initiation factors and GTP binds to the 30S ribosomal subunit. Then the initiator tRNA and mRNA binds to the 30S ribosomal subunit. Then the 50S ribosomal subunit becomes bound to the 30S initiation complex. This is all the structure of the 70S ribosome, which is present in the prokaryotes. And this process is same in case of the eukaryotes, which has 80S type of ribosome. So the protein called the initiation factors, that is IFS in prokaryotes and EIFS in case of eukaryotes, are necessary to bring all the components of the translation initiation complex together. And these factors joins the small subunit of the ribosome at the start of the process and leave when the large subunit of ribosome joins the small subunit. So the magnesium ion also takes part in the process, and GTP supplies the energy for the formation of initiation complex. The formal methionine is changed to normal methionine by the enzyme deformylase. If not required, methionine is later separated from the polypeptide chain by a proteolytic enzyme, that is aminopeptidase. So this is all about the assembly of initiation complex and in this case, assembly of the smaller subunit of the ribosome to the larger subunit. After this, the next is elongation of the polypeptide chain. And if we talk about elongation, in the elongation stage of translation, amino acids are added one by one to the first amino acid. Each addition requires the help of certain proteins called elongation factors. In prokaryotes, elongation factors are termed EFTU, EFTS and EFG. There is a more complex set of elongation factors in case of eukaryotes. Addition of an amino acid occurs in a three-step cycle, in which the first is codon recognition, then the peptide bond formation, and last is the translocation. So here in this picture, we will see every steps in the clear manner. So first, a charged tRNA molecule along with its amino acid, that is proline, enters the ribosome at the A site. Then its anticodon GGA reads and binds to the complementary codon, that is CCU, of the mRNA chain by the hydrogen bond, and GTP is hydrolyzed in this step. This is known as codon recognition, that how the codon recognized by the anticodon. After this, the peptide bond formation. So the amino acid on tRNA at P site and the newly arrived amino acid on tRNA at A site joined by a peptide bond. The reaction occurs spontaneously without the input of external energy. The reaction is catalyzed by peptidyl transferase. The latter is a large rRNA molecule of the large subunit of the ribosome. Earlier, peptidyl transferase was considered one of the proteins of ribosome. Thus, the peptidyl transferase is a ribozyme, that is an RNA that functions as a catalyst. In peptide bond formation, the linkage between the first amino acid and its tRNA is broken, and the carboxyl group now forms a peptide bond with the free NH2 group of the second amino acid. Thus, the second tRNA carries a dipeptide, formylmethionine or methionine, proline, and the first tRNA is without amino acid. This is the complete process of peptide bond formation. Now, here you can see that translocation. The tRNA at A site carrying a dipeptide moves to the P site, and this process is termed translocation. It requires energy, which is provided by hydrolysis of GTP to GDP and phosphate. As the tRNA translocated to the P site, its anticodon keeps hydrogen bonds to the mRNA codon so that mRNA moves along with it and brings its next codon to the A site. In the meantime, the uncharged tRNA shifts from the P site to E site, and from here it leaves the ribosome and returns to the mixed pool of the tRNAs in the cytoplasm. Here you can see that it is available to the transport another molecule of its specific amino acid. So the mRNA moves through the ribosomes in one direction only, that is fifth in first. This means that the ribosomes move from fifth to third end on the mRNA. The elongation cycle describes about takes less than 0.1 second and it repeated as each amino acid is added to the polypeptide. Now, the next cycle starts, a third tRNA molecule with its own specific amino acid arrived and attached A site of the ribosome and joins by its anticodon to the complementary codon of the mRNA chain. The dipeptide formylmethionine, that is proline, is shifted from the preceding tRNA on the third tRNA, where it joins the amino acid again with the help of peptidyl transferase ribozyme. The dipeptide thus becomes a tripeptide and the formylmethionine proline arginine. So the second tRNA being now uncharged and shift from the P site to the E site and then leaves the ribosome. The tRNA tripeptide complex is translocated from A site to the P site. So The whole process involving the arrival of the tRNA amino acid complex, peptide bond formation and translocation is repeated. As the ribosome moves over the mRNA, all the codons of the mRNA arrive at the A site one after another, and the peptide chain grows. Thus, the amino acids are linked up into a polypeptide in a sequence communicated by the DNA through the mRNA. The four letters language of the DNA, that is ATGC, is transcribed into a four letter language of mRNA, that is AUGC, which is translated into a 20 letter language of polypeptide. A polypeptide chain is the process of synthesis, is often called a nascent polypeptide. The growing polypeptide chain always remains attached to its original ribosome and is not transferred from one ribosome to another. Only one polypeptide chain can be synthesized at a time on one ribosome. So this is the complete process of the elongation. It is a very vast process of translation. Now here you can see the last step in assembly of the amino acid, which is the termination and release of polypeptide chain. So here in this picture you can see the translation termination process. So at the end of mRNA chain, there is a stop or terminator codon, that is UAA, UAG or UGA. It reaches the A site but is not read and joined by the anticodon of any tRNA amino acid complex. Hence, there can be no further addition of amino acid to the polypeptide chain. A protein called release factor joins the stop codon in the A site. So, it adds a water molecule to the polypeptide chain, and this hydrolyzes the complete polypeptide from the tRNA, that is at the P site. The polypeptide is now free from the ribosomes. The ribosomes jumps off the mRNA chains at the stop codon and dissociates into its two subunits, that is smaller and larger subunit. The ribosomes and the tRNA on release from the mRNA can function again in the formation of the another polypeptide. Here you can see in the termination of translation, that is released polypeptide chain, and here both the ribosome subunit, that is small and large, dissociate and mRNA free again for the next polypeptide formation. So in case of eukaryotic translation termination occurs when a stop codon is translocated into the A site of the ribosome. There is no tRNAs with anticodons complementary to the termination codon. Instead, releasing factor recognizes termination codons and binds to it to terminate the protein synthesis. The release factors bind to a termination codon at the A site and stimulates hydrolysis of the bond between the tRNA and the polypeptide chain at the P site. This results in the release of the completed polypeptide from the ribosomes. The tRNA is then released and the ribosomal subunits and the mRNA template dissociate. After this is the complete process of translation. After this, you can see here the fifth step, that is modification of the released polypeptide. The just released polypeptide has primary structure, which means it is a straight and linear molecule. So, because of that, it may lose some amino acid from the end with the help of an exopeptidase enzyme and then coil and folds on itself to acquire secondary and tertiary structure. It may combine with other polypeptides to have quaternary structures also. A gene determines the primary structure of the protein, and the primary structure in turn determines the conformation. Chaperone proteins may help polypeptide fold correctly. The proteins synthesized on free polysomes are released into the cytoplasm and functions as structural and enzymatic proteins. The proteins formed on the polysomes attached to ER, that is endoplasmic reticulum channel, and are exported as cell secretions by exocytosis after packaging in the Golgi apertures. Now, polysome formation. In this picture, you can see when the ribosome has moved sufficiently down the mRNA chain towards the third end, another ribosome takes up position at the initiator codon of the mRNA and starts synthesis of a second copy of the same polypeptide chain. At any given time, the mRNA chain will therefore carry many ribosomes over, which are similar polypeptide chains of varying length, shortest near the initiator codon and the longest near the stop codon. A row of ribosomes joined to the mRNA molecule, as already mentioned in the previous slide, is called a polyribosome or simply polysome. So this is the polysome formation, that is the modification of released polypeptide. After this, now the translation amplification. So what is translation amplification? Synthesis of many molecules of the same polypeptide simultaneously from one mRNA molecule by a polysome is called translational amplification. Now, energy used in this process. So here ATP plus 2 GTP molecule in presence of formation of the peptide bond form AMP plus 2 GTP plus 4 molecule of H2PO3 2 minus. So here the question is, where we get the two molecules of GTP? When GTP is hydrolyzed to GDP, as each successive amino acid tRNA complex attached to the A site of the ribosomes, and second GTP is broken down to the GDP as the ribosome moves to each new codon in the mRNA. So one ATP is hydrolyzed to AMP during the amino acid activation. Thus, the formation of each peptide bonds use three high energy molecules, one ATP and two molecule of GTP. Now the question is, why are DNA and ribosomes located at different sites? Location of instruction center and manufacturing center. The instruction center is DNA and the manufacturing center is ribosome. At different sites in a cell is advantageous. If both were in the nucleus, the manufacturing center would be far away from the energy source and raw materials. And if both were in the cytoplasm, the information center would be exposed to respiratory breakdown. So, the nuclear envelope preserves stability of the DNA by protecting it from the respiratory destruction. The genes are thus permanent, authentic master documents from which the working copies are prepared in the form of mRNAs. And the next is, how inhibition of protein synthesis in prokaryotes. Protein synthesis in bacterial is inhibited by the certain antibiotics at various stages. Such antibiotics include tetracycline, streptomycin, chloramphenicol, erythromycin and neomycin. Inhibition of protein synthesis clears the bacterial infection without harming the humans. And this indicates that there is some difference in the molecular structure of prokaryotic and eukaryotic ribosomes. After this, in this picture, you can see the complete process of the protein synthesis, that is translation. Translation is the second part of the central dogma of the molecular biology. It is the process in which the genetic code in mRNA is read to make a protein. Translation is illustrated in the diagram here. After mRNA leaves the nucleus, it moves to a ribosome which consists of rRNA and proteins. The ribosome reads the sequence of codons in mRNA and molecules of tRNA bring amino acid to the ribosome in the correct sequence. To understand the role of tRNA, you need to know more about its structure. Each tRNA molecule has an anticodon for the amino acid it carries. An anticodon is complementary to the codon for an amino acid. For example, the amino acid lysine has the codon AAG. So, the anticodon is UUC. Therefore, lysine would be carried by a tRNA molecule with the anticodon UUC. Whereas the codon AAG appears in mRNA, a UUC codon of tRNA temporarily binds. While bound to mRNA, tRNA gives up its amino acid. With the help of rRNA, bonds form between the amino acid as they are brought one by one to the ribosome, creating a polypeptide chain. The chain of amino acid keeps growing until a stop codon is reached. After a polypeptide chain is synthesized, it may undergo additional process. For example, it may assume a folded shape due to interactions between its amino acids. It may also bind with other polypeptide or with different types of molecules such as lipids or carbohydrates. Many proteins may travel to the Golgi apparatus within the cytoplasm to be modified for the specific job they will do. So this is all about the translation process. Now, in this picture you can see how the DNA in the nucleus serves as a template. Then the mRNA is processed before leaving the nucleus. Then when mRNA is formed, it has codon. After, mRNA moves into the cytoplasm and becomes associated with the ribosomes. Then tRNA with the anticodon carries amino acid to mRNA. Then anticodon-codon complementary base pairing occur. Then peptide chain is transferred from the resident tRNA to the incoming tRNA. And tRNA departs and will soon pick up another amino acid. So this is the complete process of the translation. Now, what is the main difference between the prokaryotic and the eukaryotic protein synthesis, means translation? So, eukaryotic mRNA molecules are monocistronic, while the prokaryotic mRNA molecules are polycistronic. In eukaryotes, protein synthesis occurs in the cytoplasm, while the prokaryotic protein synthesis begins even before the transcription of mRNA molecules is completed. This is called coupled transcription translation. In eukaryotes, most of the genes have introns along with exons, while in prokaryotes do not have introns. In eukaryotes, primary mRNA transcript undergo primary or processing and splicing to change into a functional mRNA, while in prokaryotes, splicing of mRNA transcript does not occur. In eukaryotes, first amino acid methionine entering the ribosome is not formulated, while in prokaryotes, the first amino acid methionine is formulated into N-formyl methionine. In eukaryotes, the number of initiating factors is much more than the prokaryotes. In eukaryotes, mRNA molecules are modified by the addition of a fifth G-cap formed methylated guanosine triphosphate, while no such cap is formed at the fifth end and in the bacterial mRNA in prokaryotes. After this, a poly A tail formed of about 200 adenine nucleotides is added at the third end of the mRNA eukaryotes, while no poly A tail is added to the bacterial mRNA. So, this is the complete description about the prokaryotic and the eukaryotic transcription and in their differences. So, in the complete process of the protein synthesis, first is the initiation, and during initiation, the component of the translation apparatus comes together with an mRNA and the tRNA carrying the first amino acid binds to the start codon. Then elongation, in which the during elongation amino acids are brought to the mRNA by tRNA and are added one by one to a growing polypeptide chain. And the last is termination. During termination, a stop codon in the mRNA is recognized by the protein release factor and the translational apparatus comes apart, releasing a completed polypeptide. So this is initiation, elongation and termination process of the protein synthesis. After this, now the gene expression. What is gene expression? Expression of gene is the process by which the information encoded in the gene is used in the synthesis of a functional gene product, such as polypeptide. So, in the mechanism of gene expression, a gene contains the blueprint or code for a particular polypeptide in the form of a specific sequence of its base pair. It transfers its code to the mRNA transcribed from it. The process is called transcription. Only the sense strand of the DNA is capable of transcription. Other genes transcribed are RNA and tRNA. The mRNA binds to ribosome and with the help of suitable tRNAs, select the required amino acid and links them in a proper sequence received from the gene to form a polypeptide. This process occurs on the ribosomes and is called translation. The polypeptide chain so formed may act as a structural protein and form some organelles or from proteinaceous biochemicals such as hemoglobin, insulin, etc. or serves as an enzyme and catalyzes some chemical reaction, or have a motile role like that of myosin or act as a membrane receptor. In other words, the polypeptide may contribute to a morphological or a functional trait of the cell and organism. Thus, the molecular structure of a gene is expressed in a phenotype, and this process is described as one gene transcription forms rRNA, mRNA and tRNA. Then after the translation, it forms one polypeptide and it expresses organelles, enzymes, proteinaceous biochemicals. So there is a definite relationship between the genes and proteins present in a cell or an organism. A change in the gene would change the code and give rise to a different polypeptide. So this is all about the gene expression. Now, here you can see the collinearity of the gene, that is DNA, and the polypeptide structure. So here you can see the concept of the collinearity. The nucleotides are arranged in the gene in a linear manner, and so are the amino acids in the polypeptide. So the sequence of amino acids in the polypeptide chain is dictated by the order of the nucleotide bases in the messenger RNA. And this in turn is dictated by the sequence of the nucleotide bases in the gene. Thus, the sequence of the amino acid in the polypeptide chain corresponds to the sequence of the nucleotide bases in the gene that codes for it. The gene and the polypeptide it codes for are said to be collinear, and their correspondence is called collinearity of gene and the polypeptide structure. That the gene and the polypeptide it codes are collinear and has been presumed earlier, but Charles Janowski and associated with now proved it in 1965, and they have shown that an alteration in a specific codon in DNA leads to an alteration of the amino acid in a corresponding location in the polypeptide synthesized by the mutant individual of E. coli. Now here you can see that each amino acid is coded by a set of three consecutive nucleotide bases. A polypeptide chain of 500 amino acids will be coded by a gene of 1500 nucleotide bases. In this picture, you can see there is demonstration of the collinearity of the gene and polypeptide in case of E. coli. A change of a specific codon in DNA sequence cases, a change of a specific amino acid in corresponding position in the polypeptide. So this is all about the collinearity of the gene and polypeptide structure. Now, here, the central dogma, that is flow of information in molecular biology. In this picture, you can see that is DNA forms the DNA by replication, then DNA forms the RNA by the transcription, and RNA forms the protein by the translation. So, the chromosomal DNA is the primary information center, and it contains complete information about the specific proteins to be synthesized in the cells for their need. And this information is coded in the DNA as a particular sequence of bases called the genetic code. So, Here, the information is passed one by the DNA of the gene located in the sense strand to the mRNA, transcribed from it as a single chain of the complementary bases. The mRNA, with the help of tRNA and ribosomes, then direct the specific amino acids to come together and join in a sequence communicated by the DNA. By this arrangement, the information initially coded as the specific sequence of DNA is transcribed and a specific sequence of complementary ribonucleotides in the mRNA and is finally translated into a specific order of the amino acids in the polypeptide chain. So, the transcription does not change the genetic code as it forms the mRNA which is complemented to the DNA producing it, except that T is replaced by U. Translation changes the codon, that is code, from the nucleotide sequence to the amino acid sequence. And this flow of information from DNA to mRNA and hence to a polypeptide is called central dogma of molecular biology. And this concept was advanced by Crick in 1958. It emphasized that the flow of information is unidirectional in the cells. Only DNA self-replicates. DNA is not made on RNA or polypeptides template. Similarly, mRNA sequence is never copied on polypeptide template. The information that has passed from DNA to mRNA and thence to polypeptide has reached the end of the line and is not reversed. And three processes are involved in the inheritance of genetic information. These are replication, that means formation of DNA from DNA. Then the transcription, that means formation of DNA, RNA from DNA, which occur in the nucleus. And then the formation of polypeptide from the mRNA, that is known as translation in the cytoplasm. So, in 1970, H.M. Temnin and D. Baltimore reported that the RNA, which functions as the genetic material in the cancer-causing chicken virus, first synthesized a DNA copy of it, and the DNA then transfer information to the mRNA, which finally passes it to the polypeptide. And this discovery in the molecular biology introduced the concept of central dogma reverse or Temnism. It states that the information flowing not necessarily from DNA to RNA, but may be from RNA to DNA also. And the reverse transcription is aided by a RNA-dependent DNA polymerase enzyme called reverse transcriptase. So this is the information flow in case of molecular biology. That means formation of DNA by the DNA replication, then the RNA found by the DNA, that is transcription, and then formation of protein by RNA is translation. Here you can see the reverse transcription, that means formation of DNA by RNA. So this is the whole process of central dogma. Here you can see the reverse process also. Now after this, the next is RNA world. There is a well-accepted view that the first and most primitive life forms lived in an RNA world in which not only did RNA store genetic information, but also used to act as catalyst and catalyze the reactions required by these early life forms. There are enough evidences which suggest that RNA of primitive organism acted both as genetic material as well as a catalyst, and some of these evidence are here. Some ribosomal RNAs of the ciliates tetrahymena are involved in the splicing operation, which cut out an intron within themselves. Primer RNA is required for the initiation of DNA synthesis. mRNA, tRNA and rRNA are required for the protein synthesis. RNA molecules can catalyze the synthesis of nucleotide 4-thiouridine from 4-thiouracil and activated ribose. And ribose nucleotide are present in ATP. But the molecules of RNA are comparatively more unstable. Therefore, DNA has evolved from the RNA with certain chemical modifications and now has become more stable. Now, relationship between the genes and enzymes. So, if we talk about the one gene, one enzyme hypothesis here, as each enzyme is the origin in biosynthetic pathway, Biddle and Tatum were able to isolate mutant restraint with a defective form of that enzyme, and the mutation was always located at one of a few specific chromosomal sites. Most importantly, they found there was a different site for each enzyme. Thus, each of the mutant they examined had a defect in a single enzyme caused by a mutation at a single site on one chromosome. Biddle and Tatum concluded that the genes produce their effects by specifying the structure of enzymes, and that each gene codes the structure of one enzyme. So here, the process of the Biddle and Tatum's one gene, one enzyme hypothesis, the concept that the gene contains information for the synthesis of enzyme, which are protein in nature, was put on firm footing by Biddle and Tatum in 1948 with the help of their experiment on the pink bread mold Neurospora crassa. This mold can grow normally in a simple minimal medium containing salts and sugar, preparing all after materials such as amino acids, purines, pyrimidines, etc. by enzyme catalyzed reaction. Such a normal or wild type individual is called a prototroph. They exposed the molds to X-ray, which were known to cause the heritable gene mutations by changing the base sequence of the DNA. They found that the mutants were unable to grow in the minimal medium unless additional nutrients were added to the medium. Such nutritional mutants are known as auxotrophs. Different mutants need to amino acid ornithine or citrulline or arginine for their growth. It is known as a cell can sequentially change ornithine to citrulline and the latter to the arginine using a specific enzyme for each conversion. Here you can see that the Biddle and Tatum experiment on Neurospora crassa, the pink bread mold, type 1 mutant, have defective gene A and lack enzymes A. Hence, need ornithine or citrulline or arginine for the growth. Type B mutant have defective gene B and lack enzyme B. Hence, need here the citrulline or ornithine for growth. Type 3 mutant have defective gene C and lack enzyme C. Hence, need arginine for growth. Wild type grown in minimal medium and does not need any additional material for the growth. So, they thought that each gene had the information for producing a single enzyme and proposed their famous one gene, one enzyme hypothesis in 1948. This hypothesis states that each gene controls the synthesis of a specific enzyme or a particular protein. And this hypothesis got them 1958 Nobel Prize in Medicine. Their work laid the foundation of biochemical genetics. So this is the one gene, one enzyme hypothesis, which is given by the Biddle and Tatum. Now, the modifications of Biddle and Tatum's hypothesis. It has been found that all genes do not produce enzymes, and the certain proteins contain more than one polypeptide chains. For example, the hemoglobin molecules consist of two alpha and two beta polypeptide chains. Similarly, the enzyme tryptophan synthetase of bacterium E. coli consists of two polypeptides A and B. And these cases show that more than one gene may control the synthesis of a protein. Hence, it is now held that one gene is responsible for the formation of one polypeptide chain, and one gene, one enzyme hypothesis has been replaced by one gene, one polypeptide chain principle. Now, Mendelian principles and enzymic role of the genes. Mendelian principles can be explained on the basis of enzyme controlling roles of the genes. The dominant genes code for the synthesis of active enzymes, and the recessive genes code for the inactive or defective enzymes. These enables the dominant genes to produce their phenotypes even in the presence of their recessive alleles. In homozygous person, both the genes direct the synthesis of inactive forms of the enzymes. Hence, such persons suffer from abnormality. How? So here, a specific case, that of alkaptonuria, is cited. In homozygous dominant person, both the genes direct the synthesis of active alkapton or homogeneistic oxidase enzyme. Therefore, such persons are normal. In heterozygous persons, one dominant gene directs the synthesis of active alkapton oxidase enzyme and the other recessive gene directs the synthesis of an inactive form of this enzyme. Such persons are also normal. In homozygous recessive persons, both the genes direct the synthesis of inactive form of the enzyme. Hence, the such persons suffer from alkaptonuria. So, this is Mendelian principles and enzymic role of the genes. Now, after this, the difference between the DNA and RNA. So, according to the acid name, DNA is deoxyribonucleic acid and RNA is ribonucleic acid. According to stability, DNA is very stable while the RNA is less stable. In found in condition, DNA in nucleus, mitochondria and also in plastids, while RNA found in nucleus and cytosol. In according to functions, DNA is static digital genetic data storage and the RNA is dynamic many varied functions. According to the copied enzymes, DNA polymerase is used and in case of RNA, RNA polymerase is used. According to structure, DNA is long nucleotide chain while the RNA is short nucleotide chain. DNA has two complementary strands, RNA has one strand. DNA has A, B, C form of helix while the RNA has A form helix only. According to the backbone that is inorganic phosphate is same in both cases. While in case of deoxyribose, here D in DNA and ribose sugar present in case of RNA. That means R sugar in case of RNA. According to the nucleobases, thymine, cytosine, adenine and guanine present in DNA while uracil replaces thymine in case of RNA. According to the base pairing, A pair with the T, adenine to thymine and A pair with U, adenine to uracil in RNA while the G pair with the C in case of both. According to the EM radiation, DNA is somewhat UV sensitive while the RNA is relatively UV resistant. So DNA is double stranded, RNA is single stranded. The DNA has deoxyribose sugar while the RNA has ribose sugar. DNA uses thymine while the RNA uses uracil. DNA is structured into chromosomes while the RNA is modified 5th cap and 3rd poly A tail. DNA is read by the polymerases while the RNA read by the ribosomes. DNA stores genetic information while the RNA stores information about the protein structure. DNA can self-replicate while the RNA can have multiple structures like the mRNA, rRNA, tRNA. DNA can last for a long time. RNA does not usually last for a long time. DNA is read 3rd to 5th direction. RNA is formed in 5th to 3rd direction. DNA uses and RNA uses A, C, G in both and both has the sugar plus phosphate backbone. So this is all about the DNA and RNA structure. Now, the next is difference between the replication and transcription. In case of replication, DNA replication is catalyzed by DNA polymerase which needs a primer, while the transcription RNA synthesis is catalyzed by the RNA polymerase. Deoxyribonucleotides are used in DNA synthesis, while the ribonucleotides are used in RNA synthesis. Thymine is the complementary base pair for the adenine in DNA, while the uracil is the complementary base pair for the adenine in RNA. The entire genome must be copied during the DNA replication, while only a portion of genome is transcribed or copied into RNA. In case of replication, there is proofreading function during the DNA replication. In transcription, there is no proofreading functions. So, this is the structure of the transcription and the replication process. Replication occurs in the S phase of the cell cycle while the transcription occurs in the G1 and G2 phase of the cell cycle. Replication catalyzed by DNA polymerase enzyme while the transcription catalyzed by RNA polymerase enzyme. डीऑक्सीराइबोन्यूक्लियोसाइड ट्राइफॉस्फेट जैसे डीएटीपी, डीजीटीपी, डीसीटीपी एंड डीटीटीपी सर्व्स एज अ रॉ मटेरियल इन रेप्लिकेशन, व्हाइल द राइबोन्यूक्लियोसाइड ट्राइफॉस्फेट दैट इज एटीपी, जीटीपी, सीटीपी, यूटीपी सर्व्स एज अ रॉ मटेरियल इन ट्रांसक्रिप्शन. प्रोडक्ट्स आर नॉट डिग्रेडेड इन द रेप्लिकेशन, व्हाइल द प्रोडक्ट्स आर डिग्रेडेड आफ्टर देयर फंक्शंस इज ओवर इन ट्रांसक्रिप्शन. रिक्वायर्स अ प्राइमर टू स्टार्ट इन केस ऑफ रेप्लिकेशन, while the no primers is required to start transcription. It involves copying of the entire genome in replication, while the transcription involves copying of certain individual genes only. Replicated DNA strand remains hydrogen bonded to its template DNA strand, while the transcribed RNA strand separates from its DNA template strand. So this is all about the difference between the replication and transcription. Now, the next is difference between the transcription and translation. In transcription, this production of transcription occurs in the mRNA, while the product of translation is a polypeptide chain that becomes a protein in translation. Transcription occurs in the nucleus of a cell, while the translation occurs in the ribosome of a cell. Transcription requires RNA polymerase, while the translation uses various reagents to create a polypeptide chain. Transcription is DNA to RNA, while the translation is RNA to protein, but both have cytosine, guanine, uracil and adenine nucleotides. So the main differences are, in the process of transcription, the sequence of nucleotides present on the DNA molecule is copied and carried to the cytoplasm by mRNA. While the translation, the specific amino acids are picked up by according to the codon brought by the mRNA. The process of transcription takes place in nucleus, while the process of translation takes place in ribosomes located in cytoplasm. During transcription, RNA is produced from DNA, while during translation, proteins are produced with the help of RNA. Only mRNA takes part in the transcription, while the mRNA, tRNA and tRNA takes part in the translation. So this is the complete differences between the transcription and translation. So this is the end of video in which we discussed about the translation mechanism, gene expression, central dogma of the molecular biology, RNA world, relationship between the gene and enzyme, difference between DNA and RNA, difference between replication and translation, transcription, and difference between transcription and translation. So the next video will be on the genetic code. So if you understand this video, please like and share it and subscribe to my channel Anupama Biology Classes. If you have any questions, any queries, any doubts or any suggestions, you can ask in the comment section below. Thank you for the watching.